Hello, welcome to my presentation about how to measure anything. I will basically give an overview about this book here. Unfortunately, there's not enough time to cover all the cool math, but I hope I can give you an interesting overview about the topic and the possibilities and to give you some inspiration. First, I will introduce you to the concept of intangibles and how we can handle them. Then we start off with estimations, so how can we get value out of the things we know before we take any measurements. And then I present some measurement methods. So, how do we handle intangibles? So when people think about intangibles, they think about some elusive values that you cannot actually grasp. And so there are some things you cannot measure directly, but take for instance customer satisfaction. Why do we care about customer satisfaction? We might say that our customers are satisfied when they buy more products. So in this case, we could indirectly measure customer satisfaction by sales. So if there's something care about, then there's a high chance. There's something it can be observed, then there's a high chance that there's something we can measure in one or the other way. For another example, why do we care about IT security? This is something we cannot measure directly either, but for instance, it could mean for us we have fewer virus attacks per year, fewer password leaks, the website is not down that often. So when we want to measure something, we need to find values that tell us something about what we want to know, and it depends on what it means for us, which values these are. The second point is it's about business decisions. So unfortunately, we don't have the time to measure actually everything. There must be some underlying decisions. So, for instance, why would we want to measure the value of IT security or clean water? What would be the business decision behind it? We cannot go without IT security. It is crucial that we have it. So, it doesn't make sense to measure the value of it. If we were deciding about some IT security project, then it would be a different story, but it makes no sense to measure the value of IT security as a whole. And it has to support some kind of decision for us. For instance, I heard there are a lot of managers out there who like to have some monthly or yearly reports or even weekly reports generated. But if you ask them what business decision they need those reports for, they cannot name any. And then in that case, it makes no sense to generate all these reports. So then the concept of measurement in the book, it's a rather loose concept and it might spread some argument and debate. The definition in the book is rather loose. So if it reduces uncertainty, it is some kind of measurement. The point is that actually all kinds of measurement comes with some error. So when people think about measurement, they might think that you specify some exact value, but actually this is not true. For instance, if you are taking a ruler to measure the length of a table, then you can do it maybe with an error margin of a millimeter or something. But there's always some kind of measurement, some kind of error involved. So measurements are never exact. So the concept of measurement in the book is that it reduces uncertainty. So that means it reduces the error range that you are having. And if you are reading somewhere Or if you're hearing someone claims to be 100% true, or if someone reports an exact number without giving an error range, you can surely assume that they are most likely wrong. So, and here I have an interesting example for you, how you can find out things that you want to know with some data that is available.
But one week, a couple months ago, I got a question that was actually about Google. If all digital data in the world were stored on punch cards, how big would Google's data warehouse be? Now, Google's pretty secretive about their operations, so no one really knows how much data Google has. And in fact, no one really knows how many data centers Google has, except, you know, people at Google itself. And I've met them a few times, tried asking them, and they aren't revealing anything. So I decided to try to figure this out myself. There are a few things that I looked at here. I started with money. Google has to reveal how much they spend in general, and that lets you put some caps on how much, you know, how many data centers could they be building, because a big data center costs a certain amount of money. And you can also then put a cap on how much of the world hard drive market are they taking up, which turns out it's pretty sizable. I've read a calculation at one point. I think Google has a drive failure about every minute or two, and they just throw out the hard drive and swap in a new one. So they go through a huge number of them. And so by looking at money, you can get an idea of how many of these centers they have. You can also look at power. You can look at how much electricity they need, because you need a certain amount of electricity to run servers, and Google is more efficient than most, but they still have some basic requirements. And that lets you put a limit on the number of servers that they have. You can also look at square footage and see how many, you know, when, of the data centers that you know, how big are they? How much room is that? How many server racks could you fit in there? And for some data centers, you might get two of these pieces of information. You know how much they spent, and you also say, because they had to contract with a local government to get the power provided, you might know what they made a deal to buy, so you know how much power it takes. And then you can look at the ratios of those numbers and figure out, for a data center where you don't have that information, you can figure out, but maybe you only have one of those, you know the square footage, then you could figure out, well, maybe the power is proportional. And you can do the same thing with a lot of different quantities, you know, with guesses about the total amount of storage, the number of servers, the number of drives per server. And in each case, using what you know to come up with a model that narrows down your guesses for the things that you don't know, sort of circling around the number you're trying to get. And this is a lot of fun. It's the math is not all that advanced. And really, it's like nothing more than solving a Sudoku puzzle. And so what I did, so I went through all of this information, you know, spent a day or two researching, and there are some things I didn't look at. You could always look at the Google recruitment messages that they post. That gives you an idea of where they have people. Sometimes when people visit a data center, they'll take a cell cam photo and post it, and they aren't supposed to, but you can learn things about their hardware that way. And in fact, you can just look at pizza delivery drivers. It turns out they know where all the Google data centers are, at least the ones that have people in them. But I came up with my estimate, which I felt pretty good about, that was about 10 exabytes of data across all of Google's operations. And then another maybe 5 exabytes or so of offline storage in like tape drives, which it turns out Google is about the world's largest consumer of. So I came up with this estimate, and this is a staggering amount of data. It's quite a bit more than any other organization in the world has, as far as we know. There's a couple other contenders, especially the everyone always thinks of the NSA. But using some of these same methods, we can look at the NSA's data centers and figure out, you know, we don't know what's going on there, but it's pretty clear that their operation is not the size of Google's. Adding all of this up, I came up with the other thing that we can answer, which is, how many punch cards would this take? And so a punch card can hold about 80 characters, and you can fit about, you know, 2,000 or so cards into a box. And you put them in, say, my home region of New England, it would cover the entire region up to a depth of a little less than 5 kilometers, which is about 3 times deeper than the glaciers during the last ice age, about 20,000 years ago. So this is impractical, but I think that's about the best answer I could come up with, and I posted it on my website. I wrote it up. And I didn't expect to get an answer from Google. Because, of course, they've been so secretive, they didn't answer any of my questions. And so I just put it up and said, well, I guess we'll never know. But then a little while later, I got a message a couple weeks later from Google saying, hey, someone here has an envelope for you. So I go and get it, open it up, and it's punch cards. Google-branded punch cards. And on these punch cards, there are a bunch of holes. You know, and I said, thank you. And then I was, okay, so what's on here? So I get some software and start reading it and scan them, and it turns out it's a puzzle. There is a bunch of code. And I get some friends to help, and we crack the code, and then inside that is another code, and then there are some equations, and then we solve those equations, and then finally, and out pops a message from Google, which is their official answer to my article. And it said, no comment.
So, plot twist. The biggest security risk is actually pizza delivery. So, some takeaways. As you have seen, we can get information from unusual measurement methods, so methods someone don't think about in the first place. We can even measure things if it seems impossible, and we can use math and statistics to help us fill the holes. So, now about estimations. You might have heard the famous quote from Socrates that he knows that he doesn't know anything, and I'm a little bit abusing it here in this context. There might be some philosophical thoughts that we don't know anything given the size of the universe and so on, but actually based on Bayes statistics or the part of the estimations regarding the book, we actually know a lot more than we think we know. For instance, you might not know what the average size of an African elephant is, or of a Boeing 747, but you know that there are a lot of numbers that don't make any sense. So you might have seen a picture of an elephant at some point, at least in your life, and you can say, okay, even if you don't know what the average size is, well, it cannot be 10 centimeters and it cannot be 100 meters. So maybe you think, well, it could be 3 meters or cannot be more than 10 meters. So you can at least narrow it down to some range that makes sense for you. So, and then you can ask people to give you some ranges with a 90% confidence interval. So that means they are sure that in 90% of the cases, the correct value will fall into that range. And actually, if the people you are asking those estimates from are calibrated, you would see a curve like the red one, so that most of them would be right in 90% of the cases. Some even sometimes by chance in 8 or 10 cases. But if the people are not calibrated, they tend to be overconfident. That means they are making their ranges too narrow and then have a lot more misses, like the ones here in the gray bar. So the ones with 6 or 7 correct answers, they might be calibrated among all the people you are asking, and they might just have an unlucky day. But if you are judging a whole group of people and you are getting a result like this, it's very unlikely that the team is calibrated. So, and as I have hinted, you can actually train people to give you those 90% confidence intervals. You can do this by letting them do more calibration tests, so requesting estimations from them and telling them the right answers and letting them do more calibration tests and so on. You can give them some questions they can test their feeling against, so they can be more sure what actually their 90% confidence interval is. And it turns out that if people are in decisions where they are in positions where they are making business decisions, they usually see why it's good to have that skill of making estimations, and then they are eager to learn it. But if you are having people not from decision positions, even far from decision positions, they usually, so if they don't see any sense in that, then they think they cannot learn it and they don't need this, then it's hard to train them and they usually cannot be calibrated. And why is it 90%? So here we have some bell curve with the 90% of the correct answers marked, and you see it's a huge proportion of all the answers. So actually, if you have calibrated people to 90%, you can also as well ask them for 80% or 50% intervals. You could ask them, you could ask for 100% confidence intervals, but then you would get ranges like from minus infinity to plus infinity, and it's not really useful. So actually 90% usually does a good job. So now you have some experts you can request estimations from. What to do with it? So, well, you can of course ask them before you are taking any measurements, so based on their experience, they can still give you some numbers. And you can even improve the result by don't letting them estimate for the whole thing, but for single values instead. So in our company, we are usually estimating work packages, but we are not estimating the whole project as a whole, the complete project as a whole, but the single work packages, because people might overestimate or underestimate in some cases. And if you are having a lot of single values, then those errors will cancel each other out. So now some examples of some measurement methods. First, a small introduction to different scales, because they determine which kind of methods can be applied. So we have the nominal scale, which means that something falls into a category, so something like male and female, for instance. So there's no order or no size involved. Then you are having the ordinal scale. A typical example is the marks in the school. They can only tell you that something is more or less, but they don't tell you by how much something is more or less. For instance, 4 1-star movies are not necessarily as good as 1 4-star movie. So then we have the ratio scale. That is what we usually think about when we are thinking about numbers. So it can be something like ranges or money. So you can all do all the math with it. You can apply addition or multiplication. You can say that something is twice or 4 times something else. You can do all of that. Then there are the interval scales. They are related to ratios, but they have some arbitrary 0 point. For instance, the temperature on the Celsius scale. So you have the 0 somewhere in between, but 0 doesn't mean no temperature. So you can apply addition to it. So you can add 10 degrees or 20 degrees, but you cannot say that 20 degrees is double as hot as 10 degrees. So multiplication does not work. So then, for instance, if you want to know, if you are a big company and you want to know the commuting times of all your employees, well, you could survey all your 10,000 employees, but it would cost a lot of money, so it would be expensive and a lot of effort. And instead, assumed there's some normal distribution and we have the maximum of uncertainty, you can just ask 5 of them, which you are picking out at random, and with the probability of over 90%, the median of all the people will be in that range. So this is an example that you can, with low effort, start to do some measurements and getting some value out of this. Another example, where it's even enough to pick a single sample, is when you have a nominal scale. So you have some unknown population with some unknown proportion between 0 and 100%. For instance, if they are voters for a specific party or are not voters for that party, then it's enough to take one sample, and by the rules of math and by the rules of statistics, with 75% probability, those sample will represent the majority. So, how to measure the size of a population? So, problems like this are actually very common in the business field. So, we have some unknown size, unknown population where we want to know the size of. Here, for instance, if we are a company that wants to, some environment company that wants to repopulate the fishes in a pond, we want to know if our efforts were successful. So, so we could, theoretically speaking, dry out the pond and kill all the fishes in it, and we would have our answers, there are no fish in it, but that won't make any sense for our aim. So instead, we can take a random sample of, let's say, 1,000 fish. We can put some kind of mark on them and put them back. And then we can take another random sample, and assuming our sample represents the whole population of fish, based on these sample, we can look how many of these fishes are tagged. There's actually a mistake in here. I think it must be 50 fish of the 1,000, so it makes sense. So assuming now 50 fish of the 1,000 from the second sample are tagged, we can estimate that there must be about 20,000 fish in the pond. And from this, we can also do some more calculation to get a 90% confidence interval. So we might end up with saying there are between 15,000 and 25,000 fish in the pond. And in the company field, for instance, you can look for construction errors. So you send in 2 people into a building and let them search for construction errors. And based on the overlap of the errors they find, you can make assumptions about how many unseen construction errors there are. Or for instance, you could do this with unknown bugs in the software. So then another topic that's a little bit touchy, and some people that might raise some debation, and some people don't like to do this, is to measure subjective preferences. For instance, you could ask people if they would rather donate 20 euros for charity or go to the movies. And usually people will say they would rather donate the 20 euros. But if you look at what they did last year, more people go to the movies than are donating money. So you can get an idea about what people prefer by how much, by looking at how they spend time and money. Another example, some people might claim that some piece of art is priceless, but if the artist is asking for some specific price and no one is willing to buy it for that price, then you can surely say that the piece of art is not that much worth. Or another example, imagine you could buy a car and decide about an additional security feature which will decrease your chance of death in a case of an accident by some percent, then you can look at if people are willing to spend that money to reduce their chance of death. And in this way you can even put a value on how much they value their own life. So, some takeaways. Anything can be measured. So, some things shouldn't. So, they should support some kind of business decision. There must be some sense behind measuring it. You know actually a lot more than you think you know, and you can start off with your knowledge before any measurements by doing some estimations. And you can reduce your uncertainty with measurements, but there's always some kind of error involved, and nothing is 100% certain in life. Thank you for your attention.